following interview was conducted with Ray Anne Shrader for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Monday, February the 5th, 2007, at her home in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Can you tell us a little bit about where you were born and your parents and growing up and siblings, etc.?
I was born in Salt Lake City, Utah in 1930. And I am an only child that has advantages and disadvantages. My mother passed away when I was 12, and I went I couldn't live with my father because he was working out of town. So I went to live with my aunt and uncle, and my aunt had raised my mother. So I was named after her. And so from the time I was in junior high school, or seventh grade, I stayed in Salt Lake City and finished my public school education. Prior to that time, I'd been in six schools in 7 years because my father was a traveling salesman. My mother's goal was always to have her only daughter go to college. And I'm sorry that she couldn't see that, but I went to the University of Utah, which was a streetcar college, and all I could afford. But I graduated in 1951 with a Bachelor of Science. I taught public school physical education for 7 years in Salt Lake. And then I accepted an assistantship at the University of Illinois Champaign, where I completed a master's degree. And then an opening at Purdue happened, and the department head, there was an old girls' network in those days, just like there's an old boys' network. And the head of the department at Illinois recommended me to the head of the department at Purdue. And I came as an instructor in 1959 and stayed on for a long and full and very fulfilling career.
Okay. Tell me, what was your major in college and was it the same in grad school? And why did you decide to go to graduate school?
Well, my major in undergraduate school was physical education. And my minor was technical theater, and that was my real love. And that's what I spent most of my time at in undergraduate school when in free time. And then when I was teaching physical education, I found it was after 7 years, it seemed like every year was like every other year, and it didn't look like it was going to get a whole lot different. And my head was telling me I needed to stretch. So I shifted fields and did a master's degree in health education. But then at the University of Illinois, I was on the women's physical education faculty. And at that time, they had some of the bright lights in the profession on that faculty. And TAs were treated just like faculty members. And so we were able to be in committee meetings, and we were sponsored to go to conferences. And I began to see the subject matter of physical education was changing. Something was much more intellectual and exciting. And so I finished my master's degree in health education because that's what I had started in. But after I came to Purdue and after my experience at Illinois, I knew that I would go for my doctorate, and it would be in physical education, but in those days, we began to specialize. And I did my PhD at the University of Wisconsin-Madison with specialties in motor learning, tests and measurements. And my career after that at Purdue was mostly in teacher preparation, motor development, motor learning, tests and measurements. I was what one of our faculty members used to refer to as a utility person. I taught in the early days every activity that was possible, and later as many of the lecture most of the lecture courses in the department. So that's why I wound up where I began to love Purdue University and spent much more of my career here than I probably should have in service contributions in terms of university committees and college committees and curriculum development and all that sort of thing.
Let me backtrack a little bit. I want to just ask you, when you call this a streetcar college, I'm thinking of researchers who might hear that. Can you elaborate? And what was the campus like? Did you live at home?
I lived at home.
Okay.
And the bulk of the populace at the University of Utah at the undergraduate level were probably people that were in commutable areas, and that's why we call it the streetcar college. And there was one women's dormitory on campus, one. And there were no men's dormitories on campus. And you lived in the sorority house or the fraternity house if you were from out of town. And so there were very few students who weren't in the close geographic area around Salt Lake City.
What was the campus like? What was the activity?
The campus was, I arrived on the campus the year after the GI Bill went in. So it changed its character enormously in that first year or so. You'd see veterans pushing baby prams up and down while they had their notes in a book. And before that, the campus had been mostly female, and then it became inundated with veterans. And it was a really mature people that were in competition in classes. They were serious, and us kids right out of high school were kicking up our heels a little bit. And I think the population in the school at that point was 12 or 13,000, and it's up to 30-some thousand now.
Did you join a sorority?
No, I did not.
Okay.
I couldn't afford to in the first 2 years. When I finally could afford to, I was so busy in so many other things, I thought it was a waste of money. I spent most of my extracurricular activities in athletic endeavors as well as in theater and honorary organizations. And so I had established myself with a support group and a lot of good friends, and the sorority and fraternity gig didn't seem like it was a
right
thing.
Did you ever keep in contact with any, when you ask if they kept in contact with any, were there any professors that made an impact when you were in the under?
Yes. One professor in health education urged me to go for higher education because she knew I was a good student, and had scholastic honors when I was in undergraduate school, BMOS. And I had a dance teacher who became quite well known in the profession as one of the first people who really developed educational dance curricula at college level, and Betty Hayes. And I, when I've seen her conferences, I always said, everything I know about teaching, I learned from you, because she's such a beautiful observer of movement, and she could cue movement behavior so well. And I took about 6 modern dance classes that I with her, and really enjoyed that. So yes, there's always some significant others in your life, are there not?
Right. How did you take a leave when you got free for your PhD? Because you were at Purdue at the time, right?
Yes, and tenured. I was lucky. There were some rules in those days that allowed you, after you had been on the faculty for a 6-year period of time, you could take either a semester at full pay or a year at half pay, even to pursue...
Like a sabbatical?
Like a sabbatical, and you were allowed to pursue an advanced degree. So I was able to go to the University of Wisconsin. I got a small scholarship there, which let me be labeled an in-state student, which made a big difference monetarily. But I was able to do all my coursework and not have to take a graduate assistantship or anything like that. It was one of the best years it was 1965 and 66, I guess. Great year. I met terrific people in Wisconsin, and in those days it was one of the best places in the United States.
You still keep in contact?
In physical education. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And I still keep in contact with Utah people.
Let me tell you, ask a little bit about were there two departments in Illinois? But tell us a little bit about the physical education for women department, because these are, I think, we don't have, you know, we're trying to enrich our materials, and so some things that the researchers could appreciate. Any comments?
Yeah, I made
Was it two departments also at Illinois?
I made some notes about that.
Okay.
In the 60s and prior to that time, historically, in universities, there were two departments, physical education for women and physical education for men. And then in the early 60s through the 70s, there was a movement really nationwide to combine departments. And it made sense in terms of resources, there's no doubt about that. But it was huge resistance because the focus in men's departments had been essentially athletics and the connection with athletics like it was at Purdue. And the focus in women's departments was teacher education and research and scholarly activity. And so the clash was, Purdue was one of the last to merge in the Big Ten. And we still, I think, still have one Big Ten institution that has, still has separate departments, and that's the University of Iowa. Mm. But they've combined everywhere else. But the trend in the profession as a whole, probably what happened at Purdue is it mirrors what's happened. In terms of our department structures, we went from two departments, physical education for women, PEW, and physical education for men, PEM, which was allied with athletics in that Red Mackey was the titular head for the Department of Physical Education for Men. And Wellman France did all the work of headship, but when Guy wanted to step in and say, no, you're not going to do that, you're going to do this, and you're going to take, I'm going to fire this coach, but he's going to be on your faculty. And that happened any number of times. And that's why we resisted a long time for combining here. And so finally, when the combination happened, the men's department split off from athletics. And we went from two separate departments to one that was originally called Physical Education, Health, and Recreation Studies, PERS. Then it became Health, Kinesiology, Leisure Studies. And now the Leisure Studies has been dropped as a curriculum, therefore they have changed their name once again, so now we just have the Department of Health and Kinesiology, which is a focus on the subject matter of what we study, which we always supported in the women's department. Physical education is a term that really describes school-centered programs. The study of movement behavior is what the disciplinary focus of the, so kinesiology embodies that. So it was much better name for what it was we were about,
what we do,
mm-hmm. And with the subspecialties of biomechanics and exercise physiology and motor learning and motor development and et cetera and so forth.
All right. Tell us a little bit about also interaction with the students. Were you advisor for any of the organizations? And I know, and elaborate a little bit on the curriculum, how that changed a little bit over time.
In the women's department, I was the head academic advisor for a good number of years. And so I was in close contact with the students as well as teaching professional classes. In the early years, competition among women was not sanctioned by the NCAA. And so women's departments would do it on a quote-unquote volunteer basis. So I coached tennis for 5 years. I coached volleyball for 2 years.
At Purdue.
I refereed basketball games. You got on the phone and made your schedule for the year. And finally, gradually, our department took, and I have to credit Margaret Clifton for this, try to move the competitive aspect into arenas where women could get better support for the competitive arena. So we pressed to move it out of our department structure into what became the extramural and performance clubs sponsored by the recreational gymnasium. That was the first, the beginning of intercollegiate athletics in a real structured sense. And we still did some volunteer coaching in that, and then finally try to move it into the Division of Intercollegiate Athletics so that women could begin to get some scholarships and so on. Well, Title IX came along, and then kicking and screaming, we finally got a competitive women's athletics with some real support like we have now, but it was not easy. And I've got some references for you here to probably get you some history there of some people who were real groundbreakers.
Do you keep in contact with the students? When the students finished in those days when you're doing a lot of advising, what would be their career path when they left? Did some go into, say, secondary teaching, phys ed, or?
In the early days, that was what the major was, a teaching major, period.
Okay.
So they either went into teaching or they decided they didn't want to teach and they did a whole array of things. When we changed the curriculum that was focused on the study of movement behavior, then we had students who wanted a teaching coach, so they could do the teaching major, or that we developed the movement and sports sciences major, which was merely a study of the discipline, just as you would study English literature or chemistry or whatever. And then those students, a lot of them went right on to graduate school and to their master's and PhDs in specialties like exercise physiology. And now, if you looked at the array of majors available in the department, you'd see a whole sports management, fitness leader, teaching major. In fact, I've been honored recently by having one of my former students endow a scholarship in my name, my and Jane Maber's name, Maber Shrader Scholarship for Undergraduate Physical Education.
I'm not aware of that. Go ahead, tell me about that.
Oh, well, yes. This will be the first year it's been awarded, but Dr. George Greenlee, who was an undergraduate student with us, did her bachelor's and master's here, and whom I hired to work at a summer camp. One of those bright, effervescent kids, you know, the cream of the crop thing. And she goes off and has herself an absolutely marvelous career in higher education, became an associate graduate dean at two institutions. And she crops up 2 years ago and said, I've always wanted to do this. And she's retired now and living here, and so she is endowing a scholarship in the Jay Mabers in my name, because she appreciated the mentorship she got from us when she was here. And so it's very special, special treat.
Very nice.
Yeah.
And it came as a surprise.
Yes, it did. It certainly did. I had no idea until she just said, I'm going to do this.
Were you ever a fact fellow at all on campus? Or?
Yes, for one of the co-ops, Twin Pines, for a couple of years. I also was the advisor for the Triton Synchronized Swimming Club. We put on water shows. I spent more coaching time, and then began to do more things. Academic advising took enormous amount of time and coordination for the entire department. We had about 150 majors, and some of the other faculty members would take a small, you know, they'd take 20 or this, but to keep on top of that was pretty time consuming. And then I got active in school affairs, in the Senates, and
you served on some committees?
Served and chaired committees in humanities. When the college changed its name to Liberal Arts, I was the first vice chair of that Senate, which was a special for me. I served on the University Readmissions Committee on a couple of terms. I chaired the University Grade Appeals Committee. That was a labor of love. But I really enjoyed the interactions with my colleagues all around the campus by engaging in those kinds of things.
How has the campus changed since the time you've been here?
Enormously. I used to teach on the second floor in Memorial Gymnasium, which is now Computer Science Center. That's where our department was housed. And if you taught at noon, at 12:18, you had to stop and have a little break because the train came by carrying the coal across the piece of property that was directly in front of Memorial Gymnasium that was taking the coal through the steam where the tower used to be. And so you just knew there was a little break in there, go get a drink of water, whatever, and then you began again. So you used to be able to drive all the way around the circle before there was no math science building, there was no computer science building, there was, of course, no lecture hall, 1951. Where the new computer science building is opened right now, it used to be a tiny little dirty restaurant called the B&G, the Black and Gold. We called it the Barf and Gag. But it was closest we could go grab a burger for lunch because there was very little time.
Right, yeah.
When I first started teaching here, I taught 11 classes. I got one off for coaching. 11 classes. 11 activity classes. That changed over time, of course.
Right.
But,
well, now that they physically, they're still in the building. When did you move? When did they move over there?
We moved in Lambert.
Now it
was after the departments combined, so
sometime
we would have lost the building, and that's a story in itself.
Okay.
Would have lost the building in probably 70.
According to what I read, that the chain of consolidation was effective July 1, 1976.
76, right.
And,
and it would have been a couple of years after that that One of our janitors told us that, in fact, the building was going to be taken over by the university and converted to a computer science department. In fact, our dean didn't even know at that point.
Oh, that's interesting.
But that's the way things got done sometimes, mm-hmm. out of the head shit.
enrollment, has that changed over time? Didn't it increase a lot? After the, what was the change after the consolidation? How did that affect enrollment?
Well, of course, the combined enrollment, our enrollment at that point in terms of major students is probably 150 or 180, something like that. The men, because they had health education, which was a small number of majors, but they had teaching majors, and they had a major that didn't lead anywhere. It was a house to hide, early on, a house to hide athletes. They got rid of that a long time ago, well before consolidation, but there was that period of time when that was the case. We probably went up to around maybe 500 or 600 students, and I think it's greater than that yet now. So enrollment has always been up.
Yeah, okay. I know, and they've always done a lot with the adult education, the adult programs that Ishmael and now the center. Were you ever involved in any of those programs at all?
No, actually the men's department had, Ishmael developed an adult fitness program, okay. which is the arm out of which he did most of his research. And our department developed the developmental movement education program, which is our preschool program, where we had children 2 to 5 years old coming twice a week for a 10-week period for a gym and swim experience in which we could do our motor development work in conjunction with that. So the two kind of big service programs independently were those two things. When we merged, we kept both of those programs, of course.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And some of the other programs that you, curriculum things that you taught, were talking about gathering data and things of that sort. And those are the kinds of programs that you run, along with the academic advisor.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, right.
Oh, yeah.
Good. Did your research area or focus change over time, do you think? Or?
Mine was so modest that it
pretty much stayed. Yeah. Your department, those two men, the men's and the women's departments go way back, 1925-26.
That's right, 25-26.
Ellington
came in 26.
And Elliot. And you've been under different department heads, too, since
yes, I was Helen. No, I was not. I was Helen Hazelton's next to last hire.
Oh, okay.
Jay Maber was her last hire, and that was in 1959.
She was a department head for the women's?
And she was a department head for the women's. She retired in 62.
Mm-hmm.
And then Margaret Clifton, we had a year in which Hilda Schwain, who's another name I think you probably would like to look into, was our interim head for a year or two, and then Margaret Clifton came, and that's when the whole focus of the department changed in terms of physical education and school setting program versus the study of human movement,
mm-hmm.
and curriculum and so on.
Okay.
And we carried that over when we knew we were going to butt heads with the men's department when we merged, because they were still in the only school center programs era, and we grown up and out of that. Not that we didn't value that, it was just one segment of what we did. But we were able, and I was chair of that committee, to develop a curriculum in the combined departments, reading mirrored very closely what had been in the women's department,
mm-hmm.
not
I
what
see.
Had been in the men's department.
Okay. You served up quite a few presidents. Any comments on them?
Yes.
Any interactions?
Fred Hupty was a good friend of Helen Hazelton's. And Aubrey Stewart was a good friend of hers, and so she would always, like the mother hen, take her new faculty members around to meet them, so I had a chance to get to know President Hupty and Aubrey Stewart to some degree, but that was, I didn't realize what a special man Aubrey was until later. And then after Hupty retired, and I felt sorry for him, he'd been a very good president for a long time, but his last couple of years were so hard on him. And Priscilla was a lovely lady, his wife. And then we got
Dr. Hansen.
We got Hansen, and we had there was an interim there. Was that when we had picks? No.
Was with the
Hupty really picked Hansen, as I understand it.
Oh.
And then after Hansen, we got Beery. And there was Hicks was, John Hicks was the interim there for a couple of years. And then, of course, the whirlwind came in with Dr. Jiskey.
Right, exactly. did you interact with Dr. Hansen at all at any time? So
no,
it's a little bit,
I didn't have.
A little bit different than that.
Yeah, it was different. I didn't have much. I did have some interaction with Fury. Some pleasant, some not very pleasant.
Uh-huh.
When I was serving on the Scholastic Readmissions Committee at one point, his office intervened in a decision we'd made, which I became a bit incensed about, because I was naive enough to think that what the faculty wanted is the way it ought to go. Oh, well.
Going back to the village, to the community again, the village, has it changed a lot since you've been here?
Oh, yes.
In what way?
Enormously. There used to be a wonderful little shop there, the Elsa Lynn shop, which is where all of our girls had to go to buy their gym uniforms, for God's sake. We finally got rid of all of that. And it was just a comfy little, you went, Helen Hazelton lived in the Varsity Apartments. It was when I moved here, it was the only apartment house in West Lafayette.
Is that where you lived when you first came here?
No, thank goodness, no, it was not. I was able to find a little...
Well, what was housing like in those days when you came?
It was few and far between. You were in some of these chopped up things over in the Chauncey Hill neighborhood. There were no apartment houses other than Varsity.
That was the only apartment?
Only apartment house in all of West Lafayette.
That's amazing.
And so I found an apartment. Hilda helped me find an apartment.
I imagine in Lafayette?
In West Lafayette. Oh. There was a lovely lady by the name of Mary Southworth who had little apartments chucked away here, there, and another place. And I had an efficiency for the first 2 years I was here. And then three of us got together and decided we wanted more room, so we rented a house over on Stadium that we called the Charles Adams House, because that's the way it looked. And when the wind blew in the winter, the curtains would blow out almost horizontal with the floor. The place was so windy. But we had a wonderful time there.
I love it. Do you keep active in your alumni association at all? The schools at any time? Or we usually ask if they're affiliated with some school to keep active in their alumni association, but not so much?
No, I don't. Not in associations. I have about a dozen of us that graduated from undergraduate school together still get together regularly.
Good.
In Salt Lake and call back and forth, and when I'm in town, we have gatherings.
Super.
So
it's nice to keep in touch.
Yes.
Yeah. And then, now let's see, what have you been, now that you're retired, what special activities, if any, have you been involved in?
Probably traveling has been my favorite.
Any special spot?
Well, I've been to Europe 3 or 4 times, and to Egypt, and cruising around the Caribbean, and I just came back from a transatlantic cruise, and I'm going to back to Italy for 3 weeks in May of this year. And other than that, really, I think I do nearly nothing rather well as well.
Are there any questions that I failed to ask that you'd like to share? That you want to make any, that you could make a comment on? Or, and I'm also going to ask you, what is your outstanding event in your life? Do you have an outstanding event that you'd like to share with the researchers?
No, that would be very hard to... Probably I treasure my association with my colleagues as much as anything else. And which has been lasting, absolutely. And I think probably my students have viewed me that way as a mentor, and I still hear from them. I even got a postcard from a former high school student recently, so I must have made a dent somewhere in terms of working with students. So that probably is the thing that
pleases me the most.
Really
nice. Sometimes I also ask people, are there any topics that I mentioned that you want to return to, or do you think you pretty well covered anything special that you want to add to anything?
No, not really. I think I would hope in your project you would try to dig up some history about the development of women's athletics here. And one of the parts of that that's been lost is the fact that there were many women of my era and before making contributions to that, that somehow when the NCAA took over, it was under George King's tutelage, it was like that never happened. Well, it did happen, and it wouldn't be where it is today if it hadn't happened.
If it hadn't started here.
Absolutely. In fact, one of our former instructors and graduate students became a national president of the association that was governing women's athletics prior to the NCAA takeover. And so
there was a separate organization?
Yeah.
That? Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh. AIAW was called. Association of Intercollegiate Athletics for Women. Mm-hmm. And before they were, quote-unquote, swallowed up by the NCAA, they had their own championships, which paralleled what's going on in the NCAA now.
Could you elaborate a little bit on that for our researchers? Did they arrange for women to participate, or what was the what exactly was the nature of that organization?
Well, it was a parallel to the NCAA,
but for women only.
Oh, right.
And
right. For women's athletics only.
Okay.
And by that time, most institutions were having organized competition among women, and it was a national organization that helped get it more organized,
mm-hmm.
and it was trying to implement the opportunities that became available as a result of Title IX.
Mm-hmm. Is the organization now no longer functioning?
No, it came defunct after the NCAA decided they would sponsor women's athletics, which in the long run is they had the bigger, the more financially stable and so on, probably a good idea, but it was very acrimonious. In fact, one prior Purdue faculty member that you might want to look into is a woman by the name of Carol Oglesby, who was paramount in that. She was an instructor with us, and she did her PhD with us and went on to a very prestigious career in our field. I think Temple University was where she was for a long time, and now she's back out in California. But she was really a big thrust in getting that done.
What did that association, what sort of arrangements did they make for women to participate in athletics? I'm thinking of somebody who would hear it on the tape, and did they have competition or events and things like that?
They had national championships.
Okay. And they, so that someone
had
been.
And they sanctioned schools and had standards. And,
okay.
And
I see. So similar to what NCAA is doing today, only they
right.
handled the women's thing.
And I think if you Googled them, you'd probably
okay.
find the history of that there.
Okay.
AIAW.
Any final or closing remark that you'd like to make? Anything special?
Yeah, I would hope you'd be able to dig up what contributions Helen Hazelton made here and in the profession as a whole. She was a harbinger of much in her day in terms of the support for women in physical education. And a textbook author and so on and so forth. A great lady who I was pleased to work for a couple of years.
Very good. Okay. Thank you. This ends the...